Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures.
I'm your last, O Jerusalem. I have set watchmen. I have set watchmen.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you that it is always an encouragement, and it always brings us strength and hope. And we just pray, Father, you would open up our ears to receive what you have for us today. And we thank you, Father, for the moving of your spirit upon Hannah to play a song just now that was exactly what we're going to be talking about. And thank you for that confirmation. And we just pray, Father, for you to protect us against any distraction or any kind of thing that the enemy would send to try to keep us from what you have for us this morning. In Yeshua's name, amen. Amen. Well, I feel like I need to lighten things up a little bit here. No surprise. So this is a somewhat political joke, but there was an American soccer player that played in a tournament in Belfast, Ireland. Some of you, I hope, remember all of the troubles that were going on in Ireland between the Catholics and Protestants. Everybody remember that? Okay. After one of his games, he was waiting for a bus on a deserted street when he felt a gun in his back. "What's your religion?" he heard the man with the gun growl. Bobby, the player, he had no real religion, but he knew if he said he was Catholic and the guy was Protestant, he'd probably kill him. And if he said he was Protestant and the guy was Catholic, he'd probably kill him too. So thinking very quickly, he said, "I'm Jewish." And the man with the gun shouted, "Oh, Allah, I must be the luckiest Arab in all of Ireland." Well, we are approaching the 29th of the day of Elul, the Jewish calendar month that we are in right now. It will be this next Sunday, not tomorrow, but a week from Sunday. And as I was preparing this week, I was thinking, you know, should I be speaking about the Shemitah? The Shemitah is the year of release. It's the sabbatical year that we are in. And it's been pretty obvious that the predictions about what's supposed to happen at the Shemitah are happening. I'm sure all of you are aware of what's happened with the stock market in the last week, about a 15% drop, the biggest drop in many years. And remember, the cycle was 2001, 2008, 2015, every 7 years. So I was thinking of that, and I was thinking of the things that I could recommend that you all do in the natural to prepare. And let me say that they're not a lot. If you can, get your money out of the stock market. I would recommend that. Also would recommend you store up some emergency supplies like water purification, alternative heat sources, non-perishable food items, those kind of things. And I thought maybe I'd be going in that direction, but the Ruach, the Spirit, led me back to Joshua to continue with that next chapter of Joshua. And as he was telling me, but I didn't understand it, was that this chapter is actually a preparation for the Shemitah. I didn't understand it at all, how it was, until the Spirit began to reveal to me what the application of it was to our lives. And then I began to see it. So let's go back to Joshua. We're in chapter 7. And for those of you who haven't been with us, we're studying Joshua because Joshua took the Holy Land. The people of Israel, the Joshua generation, took the Holy Land. They knew it. They did it right. And we need to learn how to do it right to accomplish what God has for us. But chapter 7 is different. Chapter 7 is the only incident in the book of Joshua where the Joshua generation got themselves into big trouble. And it was only one family, one person that did it, yet it caused tremendous, tremendous trouble. So starting out in verse 1, "But B'nai Israel, the sons of Israel, unfaithfully violated the ban, Achan, son of Carmi, son of Zabdi, son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took some of the banned things. And so Adonai's, the Lord's anger, burned against B'nai Yisrael. The ban that is being referred to here is in Joshua 6, which we just read last week, but I'll go over it. And it's given just after the Lord told Joshua how to take Jericho. So in verse 18 it says, "But you just keep yourselves from the things that are under the ban. Otherwise you would make yourselves accursed by taking of the things under the ban. And so you would make the camp of Israel accursed and bring trouble on it." So violating this command would bring a curse both on the specific violator of it, but also, God says, on all of Israel. And in 19, we find out what it was. "All the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and iron are holy to Adonai and must go into the treasury of Adonai the Lord." So those items were not to be destroyed. They were not to be kept as plunder. They were to be put into the treasury of the Lord. They belonged to the Lord. So let's read how this played out. No one except God at this point was aware that Achan had done this. They had conquered Jericho. If you were here last week, the walls fell down. They conquered the city. They saved Rahab and her family. In verse 2, "Now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is near Beth Aven, east of Bethel, and spoke to them, saying, 'Go up and spy out the land.' So the men went up and spied out Ai. When they returned to Joshua, they reported to him, 'Let not all the people go up. Only about 2,000 or 3,000 men need go up and strike Ai. So don't wear out all the people there, for they are just a few. It's a small city. We can easily take it.'" Verse 4, "So about 3,000 men from the people went up there, but they fled before the men of Ai. The men of Ai struck down 36 of their men, and they chased them from outside the gate as far as Shebarim, striking them down on the slope. And so the hearts of the people melted and became like water." So this defeat caused the Israelites to lose courage, become fearful. And really what it did was it caused them to doubt that the Lord was with them anymore. They realized that all they had done, crossing the Jordan, taking Jericho, that was the hand of God. But now suddenly they're defeated by their enemies. Verse 6, "Joshua then tore his clothes and fell to the ground on his face before the ark of Adonai until evening, both he and the elders of Israel, and they put dust on their heads." Now these were customary ways of mourning. So they were grieving. They were grieving the loss of 36 men. And I believe they're also grieving the loss of confidence that they had had when they had finished with Jericho. They were like, we're going to take this land. God's with us. Verse 7, Joshua begins to pray. "Alas, Adonai Elohim, Lord God," Joshua said, "why did you ever bring this people across the Jordan? Is it to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us? If only we had been content and dwelled beyond the Jordan." Does this sound familiar to anyone? This is identical to what the Israelites said when they got out of Egypt and faced trouble. "Oh, God, why did you take us out of Egypt? We were leading leeks and onions by the Nile." Amazing. This is Joshua himself saying this. Now, remember, Joshua didn't know what had happened. He didn't know what Achan had done. So, let me ask you this. Who is he blaming for what just happened? Yeah, he's saying, "God, this is your fault. Why did you bring us out? Deliver us to the hand of the Amorites?" He's blaming God. Verse 8, "Oh, my Lord, what can I say now that Israel has turned its back before its enemies? For when the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land hear of it, they will surround us and cut off our name from the earth. Then what will you do for your great name?" So Joshua feared that because the Israelites had fled before their enemies, now the other Canaanite tribes would hear about this defeat. They'd be emboldened and believe they could conquer Israel, and they would certainly come, and in the natural, they would be able to destroy Israel if they all attacked and ganged up together. So he was pleading with God to restore Israel's courage. And also notice that he's praying the way his mentor Moses taught him to pray. You notice that last part on there? He's reminding God that this will be an embarrassment for your great name. So he's using Moses' intercessory technique here. He's doing everything right here. He's using the right prayer technique. And then verse 10, I just love God's response. It when I read this just a couple of weeks ago, it was like, it's almost humorous. It's like, then Adonai said to Joshua, arise. Why have you fallen on your face? Israel has sinned. Yes, they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. So what's God saying? He's saying, Joshua, this defeat you've suffered, it's not my fault. It's because Israel has transgressed. And the word there in Hebrew is intentionally violated the command of God. That's the word petah. It's intentionally violating God's command. So how did they transgress? The rest of verse 11. Now they have even taken of the things under the ban of destruction. So they have also stolen and even deceived and even put them among their own possessions. So God is revealing here his omniscience, his all-knowing ability to Joshua. He knows everything. He knows what was in the heart of the people who did it. Verse 12, so B'nai Israel cannot stand before their enemies. So they turn their necks before their enemies because they have come under the ban. I will not be with you anymore unless you destroy whatever is under the ban from among you. So a very stern warning to Israel. And I hope you can appreciate this as it's a warning to us too. Transgressing God's commands makes us powerless to stand against our enemies. We'll turn our necks, we'll flee from our enemies. And the Israelites, all of them are now under that same ban. The word is cherim in Hebrew, a ban of destruction. So the ban of destruction was on the things of Jericho. Now they are under that ban. In other words, they are destined for destruction. Verse 13, arise. God's talking to Joshua again. Consecrate the people and say, consecrate yourselves for tomorrow. For thus says Adonai, the God of Israel, something under the ban is in the midst of you, Israel. You will not be able to stand up before your enemies until you remove whatever is under the ban from among you. So God has said, Joshua, stop grieving. Take action to reconsecrate, reset apart the people to the Lord. Now Joshua, he would have gone to the people and told them God's words. Someone has disobeyed. Someone has taken things under the ban. And we're going to be defeated until we remove whatever it is that was taken. And that would have been Achan's opportunity to repent and confess and bring back the banned items to be destroyed. We don't know how God would have dealt with Achan if he did that. Perhaps there would have been some forgiveness there for him if he did that. But that was not what Achan did. So Joshua began to carry out God's plan. He had no idea of what was taken or who took it. But God had a plan. Verse 14, in the morning, you will approach your tribes. It will be that the tribe that Adonai takes will come forward by families, and the family that Adonai takes will come forward by households. And the household that Adonai takes will come forward man by man. Now, it's not clear from the text what the Lord meant by he takes, how he would tell Joshua, this is the tribe, this is the family, this is the household. But somehow Joshua would know who it was. Verse 15, then whoever is taken with whatever is under the ban must be burned with fire, he and all belonging to him, because he has transgressed the covenant of Adonai and because he has committed a disgrace in Israel. So the punishment for this sin was very severe. At this point, no repentance or sacrifice would save the person, because not only did he transgress God's command, but he disgraced Israel. And the punishment was to include, and this is scary, all that belonged to him. That meant his immediate family. Now, verses 16 through 18 just kind of repeat those same words as the people go through this process. And Achan is taken. In verse 19, Joshua says to Achan, my son, give glory now to Adonai, God of Israel, and give him praise to him and confess to me now what you have done. Hide nothing for me. So give him glory that he revealed the truth here, basically. And Joshua was confident he had found the perpetrator. Verse 20, Achan responded to Joshua and said, it's true, I've sinned against Adonai, the God of Israel. This is what I have done. When I saw among the spoil a beautiful Shinar mantle, like a cloak, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels in weight, I coveted them and took them, Look, they are buried in the ground in the middle of my tent with the silver under it. So Achan confessed. He confessed covetousness, theft, deception of Israel concerning what he had done. He was still hiding, even though he'd been confronted. He'd remained silent when Joshua had said, somebody's done something. And he confessed that he buried the loot in his tent. And I believe that confession implicated his family, because there was no way he could have gotten away with that without the people in his family knowing that he was doing this. Now, take note what he had taken for later. An item of clothing from Shinar, that's Babylon, and silver and gold. So verses 22 and 23, Joshua recovered the buried treasure and set it before the Lord. In verse 24, then Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, son of Zerah, the silver, the mantle, the wedge of gold, his sons, his daughters, his oxen, his donkeys, his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had, and they brought them up to the Valley of Achor. And in Hebrew, Achor means trouble, the Valley of Trouble. And then Joshua said, why have you brought trouble on us? Adonai will trouble you this day. Then all Israel stoned him with stones, burned them with fire, and stoned them with stones. Entire family executed. And I, as I was studying this, I believe probably because they knew Achan had taken these things and didn't say anything about it. They kept silent. And then in verse 26, a memorial heap of stones was built, and the valley was named the Valley of Achor, trouble. So a very, very heavy chapter in the book of Joshua. Let's go look at what this is saying to us. First of all, what were Achan's transgressions? What did he do? Well, as far as I could count, he broke four of the Ten Commandments. He coveted. He served an idol. And you might say, why did he serve an idol? Well, he served the idol of greed in his life, because that became more powerful than the commandments of God. He lied about it and deceived. And he disobeyed an explicit command of God that God had spoken to the people for that time, taking things that were under the ban, taking things that belonged to God. So what do we learn about taking our promised land, about walking with the Lord, about achieving what God has for us from this incident? I saw five insights here. First, you probably all thought of, it's pretty obvious, get rid of any occult or idolatrous things in your house, right? Probably everybody's thinking about that. Hopefully you've already done that, but this is a good reminder to that. The second is pretty obvious too. As an individual, sin will cause you to be defeated by your enemies and cause the presence of God to depart from you. Well, let's look at that a little bit. Who are your enemies? Maybe you think you don't have any. Well, in Ephesians chapter 6, Paul tells us who our enemies are. We are not struggling against human beings, but against the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers governing this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. Now, I've encountered that some believers don't believe this holds for believers in Yeshua. They believe that because God's grace, which is great, and his promises never leave us, we can disobey him and get away without any negative consequences. Well, let me read for you Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25, an interesting verse. Speaking to believers, the author says, see that you don't reject the one speaking. That's not me, by the way. That's the Bible. God. I'm just speaking for him. For if those did not escape who rejected him when he gave divine warning on earth, think how much less we will escape if we turn away from him when he warns from heaven. Stern warning. So what the Bible does say is that when we sin, we can repent. And God will forgive us if we repent in the name of Yeshua and remove our sins as far as the east is from the west. But that is dependent on repenting, turning away from the evil and turning to God. The Bible does not promise, and it's important to understand this, that we will escape the consequences of our sin if we sin. If you break the law of the land, you will still have to pay the penalty. It's either a fine or jail time. That's not going to change. If your sin damages a relationship, repenting to God And apologizing to the offended person is absolutely the thing to do, but that relationship will be broken, and it will take time for you to rebuild trust in that relationship. So that's the second insight. The third insight is also, I think, very, very interesting. As a congregation, or a family, or any organization, sin in the camp will cause the entire organization to be defeated by our enemies, those same enemies. So this is kind of a little extra incentive for us to stand against temptation. If we give in to some temptation, it not only affects us, it also affects your family and your congregation. In 1 Peter chapter 2, we're called living stones built into a house. And I love this analogy. As living stones, each of us is resting on other living stones. And we're holding up other living stones above us. And we're to be a house of worship for the Lord. So when one of those stones crumbles or falls out of place, that weakens the stones around them. We're all dependent on each other. So we have that responsibility. And what's striking about Achan's story is that one man sinned caused 36 people to die. Those 36 soldiers and the entire nation to be defeated. And those 36 soldiers, they were righteous men, evidently. It doesn't talk about them having sinned. So we need to watch out for sin in the camp and understand that if it's there, it can have an effect beyond ourselves. The fourth insight. Joshua blamed God for Israel's defeat. And it wasn't God's fault. It was Achan's sin. And I don't know about you, but I've often heard people blaming God for their situation. Anybody ever here ever heard that or do it themselves? Whatever you're struggling with, whatever unfulfilled hope people have, whatever expectation, people blame God. Why hasn't God answered my prayers and fixed this mess? This relationship that's gone wrong, this financial mess I'm in, this job that stresses me out, this chronic disease I have, this loneliness I feel, this grief, this shame, this fear, this anger. Why haven't you taken care of this, Lord? This incident should teach us it's not necessarily God who's the problem. In Joshua's case, now this is interesting, it was the sin of someone under his authority. He didn't even know about it. And this is a sobering revelation for anyone in authority. And many of you are. If you're a parent, you're in authority. If you're a rabbi or a pastor, or if you're a ministry leader, you're in authority. If you're an employer, if you're a teacher, if you're a government official, if you're in the military, if you're a military officer, if you're a police officer, you are in authority. And this could be happening to you. What's holding you back could be the sin of somebody who's under your authority that has not been uncovered. Or maybe you know about it, but you're just passing it over it, letting it go on. Or, on the other hand, what's holding you back could be your own sin. Now, perhaps, I think all of you here who, if you knew it was sin, you would deal with it. I hope everybody's in that place. But it may be in an area where you don't even realize it's sin. And there's usually two reasons for that. Either because of ignorance of what is sin, or because Satan has deceived you into believing that that's not sin. I'll give an example. I've encountered many people, and I'm sure you have too, who are bitter about something. And they justify their bitterness by blaming the person who hurt them. Or they blame God for the circumstance. And they don't see that bitterness is a disobedience to God. We're commanded not to be bitter. In Hebrews 12:15, you can look it up. It speaks about pulling out the root of bitterness. And this is also the case concerning spiritual roots of dysfunctions. People just accept that they have a bad temper. That's just who I am. I have a bad temper. Or I'm fearful. I'm just a fearful person. I've always been fearful. Or I'm just always envious. I'm just always judgmental. I just am a critical person. I'm a controlling person. They see it as a trait, a human trait, and they say, well, everybody does that. And they don't see it as their own sin. And it's interesting, as we've gone out on the streets and asked people if they've kept the Ten Commandments, and we've asked them, have you ever told a lie? And almost everybody will say, well, yeah. Well, what does that make me? You? Oh, a normal person. Everybody lies. So there's no taking responsibility for it. But these things that I've just mentioned, these things are all spoken against in the Word of God, that we're not to be that way. So people excuse their ungodly behavior and attitudes as normal. Everyone does those things. It's just the way I am. Or they blame God for the way they have been made. God, you made me this way. You made me to be a fearful person. You made me to be bitter. I can't help it, so it's your fault, God, that I am this way. So that's another thing that we need to deal with, that we need to deal with the sin in our lives that could be hidden. The fifth lesson, and here's where the Holy Spirit showed me, this is the lesson that will help us deal with the Shemitah, with all that is unknown coming up that we might be facing. And as I understood this, I believed that I saw that the fifth insight here is the most important thing you can do to prepare for the Shemitah. Okay, so you're ready for that? The most important thing that you can do. So let's start out with a question. What exactly did Achan keep? A cloak, silver and gold that belonged to God. And what I saw was what the items were is not what teaches us an important insight. It has nothing to do with it. The important insight is that these items belonged to God. Achan took things that belonged to God. So the immediate application is if we can see and take hold of things that belong to God, if we hold on to them, it brings these terrible things. The curse of God, God's presence departing from us, our families and our congregations being defeated by our enemies. So you might be thinking, well, what's he talking about? What things do people hold on to that belong to God? And I'm sure what first thing that came to everybody's mind is probably, God says the tithe belongs to him. So hopefully many of you are giving your first fruits and your tithes to God so you can breathe a sigh of relief. It's not talking about that. If you're not, you might not want to breathe that sigh of relief because God says that if you're not tithing, you're robbing him. So what else? Because we're not going to talk about tithing here. What else do you and I possibly have that belongs to God? He says we can keep 90% of the money. The Spirit is not shining his light on material things today that we would keep from God. Many of us are holding on to non-material things that belong to God. And I can kind of break them into two categories. Some are good things, like our rights. Rights are a good thing. Holding on to our rights, holding on to our hopes, our personal comfort, our positions, our financial security, holding on to those things. Some are bad things, like I mentioned before, fears, bitterness, anger, secret sins, dysfunctional behavior, ungodly attitudes. Anybody here see how they might be holding on to some of those things besides me? Anybody? All right, okay. Some, like fears and anger, you may have even tried to give to God. And what happens? You take it back, right? You ever hear that kind of analogy that says the only problem with a living sacrifice is that it gets up and gets off the altar? So we give things to God. How many have given something to God and then find out, oh, I took it back. I'm doing it again. So that happens. But there's another thing that people hold on to that's very important to recognize. If you're holding on to this thing, you will struggle with giving any of those other things to the Lord and leaving them in his hands. So what is it? Well, we're going to look at one of the most powerful, convicting things that Yeshua said in all the time that he was here. Mark chapter 8, verse 35. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the sake of the good news will save it. There's two statements here. I'm going to look at each one. First, Yeshua said, you will lose your life if you try to save it. Now, he didn't mean if you try to save it by protecting it from physical injury or death. He meant if you try to save it from separation from God in this life and the next life, if you try to save yourself from being destined to hell, if you try to save yourself by working very hard to be good, to be right with God in this life and the next, it won't work. You will lose your life and be separated from God. In the 49th Psalm, it says this: none of them can by any means redeem either himself or his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him, for the ransom of a life is too costly, and the price one can pay can never suffice. We can never pay the price for the things that we've done that have been against God's word. Sometimes when we're out on the street, we'll ask somebody who thinks that they're going to heaven, well, why would God let you in? You already admitted you broke the Ten Commandments. Well, I've done good things to make up for it. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Because the Bible teaches you can only have your sins atoned for by accepting the sacrifice Yeshua made for your atonement. That's the only sacrifice that is valuable enough to pay the price. Trying to do it yourself means you're not understanding the incredible high cost of what the Lord did in sacrificing his life. You're despising it. You're saying, oh, I can do some things that are just as valuable as what he did, and I'll pay the price. Now, most of you and most people listening, I suspect, understand this part about losing your life if you try to save it. It's called self-righteousness if you think you can save your own life. But the second part of the statement is what we really need to focus on here. Yeshua said you have to lose your life to save it. If you try to save your life, you'll lose it. Got that? You understand that? But you have to lose your life to save it. This is one of the greatest paradoxes that Yeshua ever taught. So what did he mean? You have to lose your life to save it. Oh, commit suicide. No, he didn't mean that at all. Losing your life for his sake and the sake of the good news means giving yourself to God as his servant, a servant of Yeshua in spreading the good news. And it means no longer considering your life as belonging to you, no longer owning it, no longer trying to keep your life under your control, but submitting it to serve God and be under his control. Now, Rabbi Shaul, Paul went even beyond this, beyond calling himself a servant, like I've said. In Romans chapter 1, he writes, from Shaul, a slave of Messiah Yeshua. He called himself a slave or a bondservant in other translations because a servant gets paid. In that culture, a servant was a paid employee, and a servant could quit. They could go and serve somewhere else. But a slave or a bondservant was committed to serving his master for life, no matter how difficult that service became, and without any pay. So, what might you own that belongs to God? Well, plenty. Your life, your time, your energy. We're supposed to give our lives to the Lord, everything. Now, when the Holy Spirit was drawing me to the Lord, it was relatively easy for me to see I couldn't save my own life. If you try to save your life, you'll lose it. I could see that. I needed him to atone for me. But what I struggled with was that I had to lose my life. I knew what that meant deep inside. It meant giving God control, making him the boss. And I believe many believers forget that this submission of our lives is an integral part of getting saved, of being born again, of becoming a child of God. That's what it's all about. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says this: if you acknowledge publicly with your mouth that Yeshua is Lord and trust in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be delivered or saved. Acknowledging publicly that Yeshua is Lord means making him your Lord. It means living as if he's the boss and you are his bondservant. Now, I made Messiah Lord 38 years ago when I was saved. And for those of you who made a similar commitment, perhaps as long ago, you're probably thinking, yeah, I'm glad I did that. I did that. Well, the Holy Spirit isn't going to let you get away with that. There's still something to deal with. Because here's what I found. Over the 38 years, the Ruach has revealed to me that there are areas of my life that I had not given to the Lord. I thought I'd give it all, but there were areas I had not given to him. Some I didn't even realize I was holding on to. Some, like we talked about before, I give to God, and then I take it back. Well, what kind of things? Well, the first one that comes to my mind is pride. The esteem in the eyes of other people. Fears. Fears of failure. Fears of being rejected. Finances. Still worrying about whether he's going to supply after he's done it for 38 years. Expectations of other people. Things that I expect from other people, and when they don't come through, it's like, God, I just got to give that to you. Things I had personally invested in, put a lot of time and energy in, and turned out it wasn't going to work out. Got to give those things to the Lord. I believe a large part of what Paul is talking about, of working out my salvation, has been the process of realizing what are the things that I haven't given over and giving those things over. So, why would you give God such an important thing? Your life. Nothing more important than that. Why would you give it to him? You submit to him as Lord. Well, a couple of reasons. First of all, and this could be shocking, giving God your life by submitting to Yeshua as Lord is not optional. It's required for saving your life. That's what he's saying here. Unless you lose your life to me, you're not going to save your life. It's required for salvation. Holding on to things that you want or want to do means he's not Lord of those things. Nothing is to be more important to you or to me than the one who saved us. No person, no philosophy, no ministry, no position, no organization, no material thing, no rights, no hopes, no personal comfort, no position. I said that already. No financial security, no fears, no bitterness, no anger, no secret sins, no ungodly attitudes. None of those things is to be more important to us than God himself. So we are to give those things to the Lord. The second reason for giving God control of your life. If you were to ask God to save you, forgive your sins, make you his child, without submitting to his lordship, it's hypocritical. God cannot honor that request. Why? Because in the same breath that you're asking him to forgive you for disobeying his commands, you're not submitting to him as Lord, which is his command. You would be at the same time violating the command to submit to him and see him as God. Where is that command? Well, the first commandment. You shall have what? No other gods. What does that mean? That means he's the only one you are to serve. He is the one who's to be the boss. So finally, let me wrap up here by saying that two godly attitudes are required to give your life to the Lord, two godly understandings. The first is, I need to have fear of the Lord. Understanding that you and I are in danger of suffering the penalty of God's judgment in this life and in the next life for our disobedience to his commands. And the only way to have that penalty paid and to have a place reserved in heaven and not in hell is by receiving Yeshua's atoning sacrifice. And second, you have to trust Hebrews 11:6. He is a rewarder of those who seek him. And this is a tough one for some of us. We have to trust that God will reward us for seeking him. That his ways, he knows what's best for us. Oh, but God, I really think I need this. And God's leading you down a path that's not going to lead to this. But we have to trust, this is a big step of faith, that whatever God's plan is for your life, whatever he has for you, it's the best possible plan for your life. Why? Because only he can see the future. Only he knows what's coming. Only he knows what's going to come down and what his plan is for you. So, back to preparing for the Shemitah. Only God knows what's going to happen in the next months and year. How severe it will be. And this is why I believe the Spirit directed me that the best thing that we can do to prepare for the Shemitah is to take an inventory. Say, God, is there anything that belongs to you that I'm holding on to, that I'm clinging to, that is more important than you, oh God? So let's stop and pray. Father, we thank you for this passage, this chapter. We thank you for revealing in this chapter the severe danger of sin. And I pray right now, if you can just agree with me, Lord, give us contrite hearts. Give us contrite hearts. That means to be open to the light of your Spirit, revealing even secret sins, so that we can become right with you. We can repent, be forgiven, and have that victory that you want us to have. That taking of our promised land, that victory over our enemies. Father, also help us to understand that damage our sin does to others. That will help us to stand strong, to resist temptation. So now, Lord, we've asked for contrite hearts. Show us if there are any idolatrous or cult objects, the material things, in our possession. Anything that has become an idol to us. Anything that belongs to you. And then, Father, if we've done this, we repent of blaming you or others for the struggles we're going through in life. We ask your forgiveness. We know we don't see everything. We don't see what's all going on. May your Spirit open us up and reveal to us our part in those struggles, what we need to deal with. And Father, we repent of trying to save our lives by our own efforts, in whatever level we've tried to do that, Lord. And we receive your atoning sacrifice to pay the penalty for our sins. And finally, Lord, thank you for telling us we have to lose our lives to save them. What a hard, hard thing to understand and to abide by. Show us, Lord, the danger and the hypocrisy of not losing our lives for you, of not making you Lord when we want your salvation. And finally, Lord, show us if there are hidden areas in our lives that we're holding back from giving to you. So let's be quiet for a moment. Let the Holy Spirit speak. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that some of the emotions we feel are actually indicators of the things we haven't given you. Some of the fears we have. Show us through those things, Lord, the things that we're holding on to. And if you've got something right now, just put it out there and put it on the altar. Lord, I just give to you the things you've revealed that I've been holding. I just give them to you right now, Father. They're yours. Take them. I give them to you. And if you're willing, you can pray along with me. Lord, I give my life to you. I make you Lord. I've tried before, but I'm understanding it more today. That you have to be the boss. You have to be the one in charge. I give it to you, Father. Guide me, lead me. I trust that you have know the best for me. I trust that you have a plan that's better than any plan I could come up with. And I just give these things to you, Lord. And I pray, Father, for the things that I believe you've put in me of dreams and hopes. And I just thank you that you are going to fulfill, Father, the ones that are yours, the ones that come from you, Father. I'll hold them before you. I'm not going to hold on to them, I'm going to put them before you, Lord. Give them back to you and let you fulfill them. Because I know that if I hold on to them, it's just not going to work. So I put them on the altar, Father, and let you fulfill them. And we thank you, Father. Thank you for this season that we're entering. And we pray as we go through the days of awe that are going to start next Sunday, that this would be a theme, Father, of your revelation of the things that we need to give to you. And we just put it in your hands right now in Yeshua's name. Amen. And amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Winton Road, Rochester, New York, 14609, or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit a featuring Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.